Okay, thank you for coming back. I trust you got a little bit of lunch. Thank you for coming back in good time. We have a fantastic panel, and I think we will wake you up. If you're not already awake, we'll keep you awake. I'm Andrew Crosby, Managing Director at ICTSD. I also wanted to thank our partners, the IWEP CAS, and Ideas Center, and of course the Chinese Presidency for hosting these series of activities over the last year or so, which have been very enlightening. And this particular meeting was launched in some ways last year. I remember discussing it, and I'm very happy to see it have come to fruition after discussions with our friends at CAS. So thank you. The session takes place in the context of 20 years of extraordinary growth and stability and global integration on policy frameworks at the WTO that have really led to an unusual period, I think. And we sometimes it's like the air. We maybe take it too much for granted. And I think part of what we'll hear in this panel is a little bit about what happens when we've taken that a bit for granted. So for some people, it seems like the engine is sputtering. But for other people, it's a problem of roads. So we'll try and find out a little bit about that. The slowdown forces policymakers to ask what's possible and what's desirable. And so we're addressing in this conference also, do we make another big leap, as in the Uruguay round? Do we try and set principles, frameworks to carry forward the diverse policy agendas of different countries? Is it protocols that is needed to knit together an architecture of the 21st century? Or is it a narrow issue-based agenda? And in the G20 context, in terms of what kinds of actions, one of the questions is, should the G20 be in this fire brigade role, or shall it weigh in more deeply into advancing governance, which is a particularly difficult task, as we've heard? So where is the limit on that spectrum? Where's the optimal place on that spectrum? And part of answering that, of course, is to understand the measures and trends and understanding what is needed the most, what's happening, what's going on out in the world. And that's the subject of this panel. So if we talk about re-energizing global trade growth and where is there potential to find new growth and to keep the system moving, in the G20 context, a lot of that is about which questions to focus on. And agreeing on the questions and the topics is a major issue. And so I hope to advance that. We've got a fantastic panel, as I say. And I think we're going to hear some diverse views on this topic. So what's blocking trade? What will we, what is the problem? We'll hear from Simon. He's got a fantastic analysis, and others. I read a little bit from Commerce Collegium the other day, which I was going to quote. It's clear from our analysis that this standstill pledge has not been honored, and the government's currently introduced far more protectionist measures than they remove. It goes on to cite subsidies, domestic content, and public procurement. So we are, at least for the perception of some, and I think maybe there's not total agreement, but maybe there's a widespread agreement that there are many areas that need to be addressed if we're going to keep this historic opening that was created 20 years ago functioning effectively. But what's the origin of the problem? So some of that problem we see coming reflected in the proliferation of agreements, of PTAs, and so on. And part of what those agreements tell us is that there's more specificity needed. When we look at those, we see a demand for specificity that goes beyond where current agreements are. More certainty and fluidity. Those are characteristics that we need to think about when we move into this question of what is it that we're focusing on. And WTO rules may need to be updated, but where are they most needed to be updated? And certainly, the issue of tariffs is a big one, but increasingly, The question is not about tariffs. It's about the dynamism of new economy. Increased focus of beyond inside the border barriers, beyond border barriers, and dynamism of multiple border crossings and so on, of standards and regulations, areas that are not very well developed, at least in WTO. So a question faced by G20 in this panel, where is that new growth going to come from? And what does trade liberalization mean these days? Some of us in the room got to hear Larry Summers ask this question a few weeks ago in a panel at Harvard. And I think his point was quite good. If we continue to talk about trade liberalization when what we're doing doesn't really resemble trade liberalization as we knew it, we're likely to get the solutions wrong. And so there's a serious reframing about what might be done, what needs to be done. So the real work is unleashing some of this new understanding, what this new dynamic is, and understanding the new language of trade. G20 has a role to play there. Understanding impact is another. Especially impact and data. So where is that impact? And one of the things that strikes us is that while governments have been entrusted for data generation for most of our history, a huge amount of this data that's being generated now, of course, is not in governments. It's controlled by other entities. The master of big data these days is business. China is making a concerted effort, as I heard back in March at the China Development Forum, to understand how to master data. China's not the only one. Many countries are doing this. But it's hard to imagine that data is going to remain the domain of governments. And so we have something to think about here in terms of the model of governance, how we deal with both transparency, notification, these kinds of issues. So this is an opportunity to discuss something I would call exo-governance. What's the governance that's coming outside of the traditional system of governance? So where's this? How does this exo-governance look like that we're working towards? And I think there's a very high likelihood we're working towards it. If you think about the ability of our current institutions to manage data and regulate effectively, there's a big bottleneck there. So reinvigorating trade growth also requires supporters and champions. And the politics of trade are increasingly contested. So some of that agenda also has to be what the G20 can do to ensure that actions are clearly communicate and push forward the frontiers for small business, for a broader group of stakeholders. There are a whole range of issues associated to those stakeholders. They are things like de minimis tariffs, customs procedures, boring things, trade facilitation, harmonization of tax approaches at the fingers, at the very tips of the branches. It's the smaller businesses that are affected, but they may well be those who are the biggest advocates of trade. The eBay data was cited earlier. This is very significant. It shows that small businesses, when they have the environment to trade, do trade. And that should be an interesting issue to explore. So let me stop there. I think we're going to hear a variety of views. What I've asked the panel, if we keep on time, is that we will do some brief redirects to each other at the end of all of the interventions. If we don't keep on time, I'll go right out to you. But if we're on time, I'll go back to our panel for quick redirects to each other, and then we'll move ahead. So if I can, I'd like to turn the floor over to Hector, please.
Thank you. Thank you, Andrew. And thank you for inviting me. Sorry, I have a cold. So my voice may not be as good as I would like. Let me start by saying that I'm going to be speaking on my personal capacity. I occupy a position at the IMF, but I'm not entitled to speak for that. I want to address one of the questions that I saw in the preface of the invitation, which is there more than the G20 can do to restore trade and economic growth? But rather than addressing like that, I want to slightly recast it as what could the T20 do to help the G20 to restore trade and economic growth? And my suggestion is that G20 think tanks could very much help by enlarging the analysis in two ways. And I will address these two ways in my 10 minutes, hopefully. So the first one is, my suggestion is that T20 or the think tanks of the G20 should look beyond trade if they want to discern what factors may be slowing down trade growth, shortening GVCs, or slowing down the growth of GVCs. Since 2008, central banks have been implementing very loose, historically loose, monetary policies, including by providing financing at a loss, negative interest rates, in real terms, and now even in nominal terms. Interest rates have never been so low, never ever. The longest records of interest rates in the world belongs to the Netherlands. And it goes back 500 years. This record show that interest rates are right now at record low levels. So this means that I don't want to criticize this. Ultra low interest rates may be entirely justified for reasons I don't want to address today. But I just want to make the point that by subsidizing capital, we can only be inviting industries to replace labor for capital, for subsidized capital. In the 90s, if in the 90s trade growth outpaced GDP by a factor of 2.5, it was noted in the morning, and in the first years of the century up to the crisis, up to 2008, trade growth was still outpacing output by a factor of 2. And right now, this was to a large extent because industries moved labor-intensive production to countries where wages were cheaper. Now, since 2008, the main central banks, including China's, by the way, have engaged in extra-loose monetary policies. Subsidizing capital for such a prolonged period of time may be reversing the economics of that equation, accelerating the trend to substitute labor for capital. This may help explain some inshoring of jobs, some increased capital intensity in countries where labor is still very abundant, and I understand that this may be the case in China. I would like to hear from my colleagues on this. And the slowing down of GBCs. Interestingly, at the last IMFC meeting, this means International Monetary and Financial Committee, which is, I would say, the political meeting, the most important political meeting from a political perspective that the IMF has twice a year. The IMFC called for strong, sustainable, inclusive, and job-rich growth. But since ultra-cheap capital makes labor substitution more attractive, it is not clear that job-rich growth could be achievable in such a context without further squeezing wages even more. I should have started by putting some of these slides. So let me go look beyond trade. So this is the cost of capital, as you see, compared over the years. Now, the fund and others are looking closely at the potential consequences of loose monetary policies. This is the cost of labor, particularly negative interest rates. But the main concern is about spillovers on emerging markets with capital accounts, open capital accounts, and shallow financial markets, perhaps weak regulations. So the questions are, what kind of macroprudential measures should countries implement to avoid spikes in financial volatility? Are financial assets overpriced? Should central banks look beyond CPI, consumer price inflation? Pension funds, the effects of negative rates in pension funds. However, the costs, it is evident that the costs of capital and those of labor are intrinsically linked. And much of the explosive growth in GVCs was related to the interest in bringing labor-intensive production to emerging markets and developing countries, where labor was is abundant and lower industries pay lower wages. I've not seen any research on the possible consequences of labor substitution, hence on GVCs and trade, of the effects of subsidizing capital on labor substitution. So I would say this is an area in which I would suggest that T20, those that are supposed to think for the G20, could be focusing on. Now, the second suggestion is to look beyond volume. So about a month and a half ago, at the IMF, we were discussing the World Economic Outlook, which is the flagship publication of the IMF. This is not a product of the IMF itself. It's a product of the staff of the IMF. So the board is not responsible for the World Economic Outlook. Yet, the research department, who is the one that actually drafts the World Economic Outlook, normally consults it, shows the draft to the board, and waits for reactions, and possibly some board members ask for factual corrections or minor changes. So we were discussing this. Now, at that meeting, the fund's chief economist, who is the responsible guy for this, was explaining that for the fourth time in a row, the fund had to lower its GDP projections. And to illustrate this, amongst other things, he noted that trade growth was barely matching that of world GDP, contrasting with what happened in the 90s and what was happening before the crisis. This was, of course, is strictly true. Now, I asked him if he was referring to trade growth measured in volume, and he nodded. Then I noted that volume could be telling us part of the truth, but only part of it, about trade growth. And that trade could be indeed growing at a different pace than what volume was growing, perhaps faster than what volume measurement suggested. Volume, why I say this? Because volume is a very well-adapted measurement for economies that are dominated by production of trade, production and trade of physical goods. But arguably, the most dynamic sector of the world's economy is volumeless. It is immaterial. It is the digital economy. According to McKinsey, the last report published a few months ago, data flows already, electronic data flows, already account for a larger share of global output growth than trading goods. Now, it's difficult to say how much trade is digitally delivered. But McKinsey used a proxy looking at cross-border bandwidth and found that cross-border bandwidth grew 45 times since 2005. And McKinsey estimates, it's just an estimate, that it will grow 9 times in the next 5 years. Of course, not all this trans-border bytes flows could be categorized as trade, because you have Facebook, you have personal photos, you share videos, you share personal documents. But it seems that it is telling a story that seriously suggests that trade flows that are delivered digitally are important. And the U.S. Department of Commerce, focusing only exclusively on one kind of flows, which is flows of data traded between a seller and a buyer at a market price. This means missing commercial data exchange between businesses and digitally enabled services delivered to end users at no price. Found that in 2011, so this is 5 years ago, trans-border data flows represented over 60% of U.S. services exports and 34% of U.S. total export value. Okay, so it seems that an increasingly significant part of the global trade is actually delivered digitally, just under our noses. Now, yet it's mostly undetected, because our screens, radar screens, trade radar screens, are still showing mostly, but not only, but mostly trading volume. This is trading goods and some associated services, transportation, payments, financial payments. To use a metaphor, and let me use a metaphor and abuse a little bit of this metaphor, but it's illustrative. Our radars are efficient at detecting atoms, goods and the associated traditional services, but quite poor at detecting waves. So this is McKinsey, sorry, I forgot to go with this. Bad at detecting waves. That is what our countries are increasingly exchanging. These are waves. This makes progress in measuring digital trade very challenging. Why? Firstly, for two reasons. Firstly, because the value of some data flows cannot be easily equated to its price. Say, if we download an application for our smartphone or tablet, or when we use an entertainment from YouTube, or we obtain information of commercial or professional value by using one of the searching web engines, we may not pay for these valuable services any discernible price. Secondly, because it is difficult to determine where digital data is coming from, as it is intrinsically ubiquitous. And this is why I've used the metaphor of waves. It may be coming from different places, because it may be at different places at the same time. I'm not saying that you see the waves expand in all directions. Okay. I'm not saying that this could not be done. I'm not saying that we cannot actually know exactly where some digital service is coming from. But I spoke with professionals. I'm far from being a professional on this. And they all agreed that this could be ultimately done, but at a cost. To discern the location where digital data is stored, and therefore where it is being sent from or exported from, they may need to interfere with the flow of data. Digital data are quite ubiquitous, as I said, just like waves. Therefore, they could be present at several places at the same time. And to pinpoint one specific point in the map, it may be necessary to interrupt the flow or to interfere with the flow, if you want. Not surprisingly, one of the most contentious issues for international digital trade regulation will be agreeing on whether and when governments can access to the information and require that service be localized in their discrete national jurisdictions. To make things even more challenging, producing atoms, this is producing goods, has a marginal cost, which may be, or rather should be, equal to the market price. However, the marginal cost of data flows is virtually zero. This is because the cost difference between sending 100 bytes or 1 trillion bytes is negligible. So not surprisingly, owing atoms or goods implies, of course, having the capacity to exclude all others from possession. And the same thing happens with, of course, intellectual property rights and traditional services. Say, I pay for a business seat in the flight back to Washington 3B, and this means that I can exclude all others from sitting at that place, in that 3B seat in that plane. However, in digital economy, possessing digital data does not necessarily exclude others from having and using it at the same time. Now, the good news, despite all these difficulties, is that the WTO is already working to improve our capacity to measure, or rather to estimate, trade digital flows. Now, coming back to my original anecdote of when Maurice Otsfeld was presenting the World Economic Outlook at the fund board meeting, he acknowledged that we may be underestimating, it's very likely that we are actually underestimating world's international trade. But we may also be underestimating world output. So it's not very clear that we can conclude what is the consequence on trade growth. Both may be underestimated at different rates, but certainly both seem to be underestimated. And he decided to include a chapter on trade on the next World Economic Outlook to come out in October. So just a few weeks, maybe a week after what I understand will come out, the World Trade Report. will be interesting to see both. I'm not expecting any groundbreaking proposal on how could we overcome our volume bias, but the IMF staff from the research department is already in contact with the WTO staff of the research department, statisticians more concretely, and I participate in this context. And hopefully this could lead to some joint work that would help us, the G20, I would say, understand the dynamics of this volumeless, immaterial new form of trade. Thank you.
Good, thank you very much. Two great points, the structural point and the measurement point, understanding where we are. Thank you. Let me turn it over immediately to Hong Song. You have the floor.
Thanks, Andrew. It's my pleasure to come here to give a short presentation about the reasons behind the global trade slowdown. I think the two issues I want to emphasize is that is after 2008, there is international trade slowdowns compared with global GDPs. And another one is that recently, in the last 4 years, the global trade slowdown furthers. Compared with GDPs, even lower than GDP growth rate. So in these short presentations, I want to give some explanations about the reasons behind these slowdowns. Firstly, for the recently slowdown of the trade compared with the GDPs, I think most important reasons is the trade decrease in the emerging and the developing countries. For example, for China's, the share of the China's import from emerging and developing countries in the last 2 decades, each year increase in this black lines, you can see, always increase the shares from emerging and developing countries. But in the last 4 years, since 2012, the shares is decreased. Yeah, and the reasons for what's the reasons for this the position of the emerging and developing countries lost their shares in Chinese import. The reason mainly because of the collapse of the commodity market since 2012. Firstly, for the primary commodity prices decrease at the end of the 2011, and then we have the fuel prices decrease since the end of the 2014. So this is the main contributions for this slowdown of global trade. And also, we have another report, actually have the same conclusions with this presentation. It's from the World Bank. Also reached a conclusion that the last year's trade slowdowns mainly come from the developing countries, especially from Asian developing countries. Yeah, this is the first point for the recently global trade slowdowns. And for the trade slowdown from 2008, and there is another one argument for the slowdowns from 2008 is something like Chinese less important from the outside world, especially for Chinese processing trees important from outside world. And this is a picture about the ratios of the import to the export for Chinese processing trees and as well for the general trees. It's from the blue bands, you can see the shares of the import surely is decreased from, for example, from the middle 1980s, something like 80% of the export after middle 1980s, something like 6%, 7 to 6%, and no, recently it's something like 50 to 60%. This is some important decrease for the processing trees. Is this a big contributions or the reasons for the global important slowdowns? Yes, we make simulations for Chinese contributions, especially for processing trees to the global import changes in the last three decades. This is a picture of that. Actually, the conclusion that is in the most of the years, the global import actually is increased very fast, always, especially from the 2001 increase each year. Some years even more, 2,000 billion increase each year. So, but every year, if we make assumptions that each year's Chinese import for the processing trees import something like middle 1980s, the ratios like that is that means 80% of export for the processing trees. So each year there is some the decrease of the important, but the contribution is to the global import is very limited. It's only in the some of the years is 10%, but most of the years is less than 5%. So the conclusion is that is China's important decrease is not, especially for the processing tree, is not the contributions for the slowdowns of the global tree, especially since 2008. So what's the reasons behind these slowdowns? Yeah, the key reasons or the key drivers for the global tree development is mainly is industrial countries. And because of the financial crisis, the impact, negative impact for those countries, they lost their shares in the global trader. For example, this is the picture for the EU and the USA lost their shares compared with China. Yeah, so this is a picture for the 70 largest economy. This is a WTO data. Yeah, the latest one. Is that it's many is from the after the financial crisis. This is the something changes for that. So the latest one is for the developing industry countries. Is that is just mentioned about the latest one is that is not only for the economic slowdown that related some the tree slowdowns as well. Also, there is a lot of the policy changes and even the strategic consideration changes. First one is some of the reindustrialization processes, policies from industrial countries in the last few years. And also to encourage some of the reshore of the global value chains to back to the home countries. And also the latest development is some of the CEOs, especially from the industry countries, from the multilateral of these countries, they want to have a different strategy, not pursue the past strategy to move their capacity to the low-cost countries. Yeah, but they have more considerations, not only for the low cost, but also for the strategic reasons for that. Yeah, this is the latest one. So for the future, if this is, I hope this is a temporary phenomenon. If this is a new directions, that would be a big concern for the new development for the global trade development in the future. And lastly, is for China, I think it's in the future, China would be the new drivers for the global trade development. The reason for that, because of the lot of the industries' capacity wants to move out for the domestic cost increase recently. We have two options. First one is we want to move this to the neighborhood countries, the middle 1980s, we welcome some of the investment from Asian needs and from Japan. But now we want to move out some of this labor-intensive industry to the outside world. We want to find some locations or countries to work together with us. For example, maybe neighborhood countries, which one is possible? Vietnam is the promised one, of course, and maybe Indians and also other countries. But this is one option. In the last few years, a lot of the Chinese firms, when they go out to want to do this, find some of the neighborhood basis to supply home market, but it's difficult. But in the future, maybe some of the changes for the neighborhood countries policy and strategy and the environment, maybe have some collaborations together. Another choice is that is a lot of the local firm also to improve their technologies, especially automations, and also use a lot of the robust to improve their productivity and reduce the use of laborers there. So at this moment, I also not very sure about which the directions in the future would be, because a lot of the capacity in the last 30 years, China was the world centers for the manufacturing and assembles a lot of the goods. It's the world centers. So a lot of the industrial capacity want to move out. So which countries, which locations can accept this huge industrial capacities? If not, another option is automations, and also use a lot of the robust to improve the productivity is another option for us. Yeah, we hope we can continue the globalization processes like happened in the 1980s when China opened up to the outside world. We cooperate with our neighborhood country and economies to work very, very well and for both of us. And, for China, and at least at this moment, it's not sure. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Excellent on big trends. Also forces us to think about, what could be the trade remedies, not only now, but what about the future? If they remain trends, what does it constitute? What constitutes an open system with these trends? So let me please pass it to Ambu now. Thank you.
Thank you, Andrew, and good afternoon. And actually, my perspective or my inputs for this panel is a little different. I want to show that is we can re-energize the global trade and investment by focusing on three areas. One is the openness, inclusiveness, and green growth. So these are some of the operational relevance for the G20 in general and G20 presidency, particularly China in particular. I want to say this openness, when I say openness in the trade and investment, means openness to include the aspirations of the other emerging economies in the region. When I say inclusiveness, this also include the not only SMEs, but also micro, small, and medium enterprises, which is dominating this economic and the social structure of the region. When I say growth, this trade and investment regimes should look beyond trade and economic policies to include the other climate and the climate resilient regimes that is already evolving, as well as the 2030 goals that the government has agreed. Basically, when coming to this trade and investment regimes to make it inclusive and to make it green. And we can look into it, what the region particularly that is in the Asia Pacific is doing. And one thing that is we can learn from the TPP and keeping aside the political economy of the part of TPP, but if you look into it, the contents, this is one of the recently negotiated and succeeded trade agreement. It shows the contents of the FTAs has been evolved, including the neighboring areas such as the investment related to the environment and the government procurements. So in our opinion, in my personal opinion, TPP appears to be the most comprehensive and inclusive economic promotion agreement. Other agreements, even including the WTO and Eurasian integration as well as RCEP, should aim for the wider coverage as adopted in the TPP, which is good for the world and good for bringing the inclusive growth. This picture shows this is the how an indicator of the regional disparities. And that is, this trade and investment should address this one, that is the access to the electricity and affordability of the electricity and the sustainability of the electricity. So this directly related to this growth and this prosperity. Current regimes, particularly the climate regimes and the trade regimes and the new energy regimes, has the possibility to converge. These are the intended nationally determined contributions agreed under the Paris Agreement. Here, under this, China has promised about 60 to 65% unit of GDP by 2030. Most of them will be coming from this renewable energy. And for the case of Indonesia, it is 29% reduction. And this for about 99%, it can improve to 41%. That means it is a conditional support that will be coming from the additional flows of technology and the finance to move into these low carbon energy resources. So this was, there is a need for convergence of this climate regime and the new energy regime as well as the trade regimes. So this convergence of the regimes also need to look into to how this growth could be decoupled from the emissions. So the decoupling the economic growth with the new investments and the new trade and industrial policies should be aimed for it. But the reality is very quite different. These countries, particularly in this region, has to need to look into the domestic reform. This is the regional average most favored nation tariff for the low carbon technologies. Here in this region, particularly that is Asia Pacific, it varies from 0% to 15%. So this trade could bring this possibility of the power of bringing the public goods by focusing more on liberalizing the trade barriers as well as the non-trade barriers associated with the low carbon technologies. There are some other facts about the small and medium enterprises. For example, in the Asia Pacific region, most of them are, about 30% of them are positioned against the global value chain. But at the same time, they contributed for the 30 to 60% of the GDP. And most of the 99% of all the enterprises in the ASEAN countries are the micro, small, and medium enterprises. So they are very much in the socio-economic fabric of these countries. So all the trade and investment regimes has to take care of the important role of these small and medium enterprises. For that, ASEIS has the ASEAN as a region has four mission goals. One is to make these MSMEs globally competitive, resilient and innovative, and seamlessly integrated among the ASEAN community, and finally contribute for the sustainable development of the region. This is the four mission statements that has been agreed by these 10 countries. Any future trade and investment regimes has to take into consideration these four mission statements. Further, to bring in these four mission statements, the ASEAN countries has also developed a strategy goals. The strategy goals include promote the productivity, technology, and the innovation. Number two, increase the access to the finance. Number three, enhance the market access and internationalization. And fourth one is enhance the policy and regulatory environment. And final one is the promote entrepreneurship, human capital development. So this trade and investment regimes that is emerging or ongoing should, there is a necessity for tackle these five strategy goals by promoting not only the trade, but also skill development as a byproduct of these regimes. I also want to show that is from the 1990, there is a change in this global value chain evolvement. Here, this Asia-Pacific region has been dominating, and its share for the world parts and component trade has been gradually and progressively increasing when compared to the other parts of the region. So it brings more opportunities for the small and medium enterprises, but it also brings in the risk. Risk and also the risk for the investment. This is what happened when these climate-induced disasters occurred, particularly in the Japanese earthquake in 2011 and followed by the Thailand's flooding that happened 6 months after it. So this not only affected these countries of Japan and Thailand, where most of these countries, small and medium enterprises are located, but it also affected the Guangdong in China and also USA. So this investment that is along this global value chain has a global impact. So this risk and governance structures has to be taken into consideration when we are thinking about the future of the trade and investment. Further, there are different international regimes has been evolving. One is the very recently concluded Sendai framework for the disaster risk reduction. It has pointed out two priority actions for strengthening the risk governance related to the climate-induced disasters as well as the other natural disasters. So the trade and regimes has to take into consideration investing in the risk reduction for the resilience, and that involves public and private investment in the risk prevention and reductions. So my message for this G20 in particular and the Chinese presidency is very clear. One is this future trade and investment regimes has to take into consideration what is happening in the region, particularly these regional FTAs and also the other intercontinental FTAs. And there is a need for more inclusive growth, and also there is a need for more green growth. So these aspirations of these small and medium-sized economies has to take into consideration to make these future investment regimes more inclusive and green. Thank you.
Great. Thank you. Frameworks and examples of frameworks as well. And not only the three you mentioned, but also complementary regimes. So thank you very much. So let me pass the floor to Simon.
Thank you, Andrew. If the G20 wants to get to the bottom of what's causing the global trade slowdown, we have to find the root causes of what's making people change their decisions about what to trade, okay? You've heard a lot of talk in the last few presentations about shifting reindustrialization and things like this. Fine, but what's causing those decisions? I want to put on the table some evidence, which I think takes us closer to that. The first piece of evidence I want to give you comes from the CEO of General Electric, who gave a speech on the 20th of May of this year, in which he announced a profound change in that company's global strategy. You should remember, but GE is a company which has 420 production facilities around the world, supplying customers in 183 countries. About 70% of that company's sales now come from outside of the United States. He pointed out, Mr. Emmert pointed out, that they are changing their corporate strategy because of protectionism. This is what he said. In the face of a protectionist global environment, companies must navigate the world on their own. We must level the playing field without government engagement. This requires dramatic transformation. Going forward, we will localize. In the future, sustainable growth will require a local capability inside a global footprint. He gave an example. At the moment, they have just one production facility which makes locomotives around the world. In the future, they're going to have lots of different production facilities all over the globe. Why? And this is the real sort of the punchline. A localization strategy cannot be shut down by protectionist politics. And so what we are seeing in this example is of an iconic multinational with operations all over the world changing fundamentally how it is doing business because of developments on the ground. Now, I do not care if certain international institutions can't monitor protectionism effectively and can't document these developments. Right? I think what we need to do is to recognize that important decision makers are changing their behavior. When we look at other facts, we see things which align with this. When we look at the export volume numbers from the World Trade Monitor, from the Copenhagen Policy Bureau, this is the outfit which everyone recognizes is the best for this business, we have seen that for nearly 2 years, world export volumes are flat. They're flat. Okay? If you look at the value of world trade, and yes, it's the value of goods trade, the stuff we can actually measure, that has been flat or falling for 5 years. Okay. So there is something fundamentally, profoundly wrong with world trade dynamics. We're not talking about a global trade slowdown, ladies and gentlemen. We're talking about a global trade halt. Halt. Stop. Not slow down. These nice euphemisms of the World Bank and the IMF. Let's get real. This is a world trade halt. When we turn to the facts on protectionism, what do we see? We see that once you correct for reporting lags, protectionism found in the last 3 years has progressively risen. We found much, much more protectionism in 2015 and trade distortions than in 2012. And it has risen year after year after year. As some of you know, my team collects this information from around the world. And quite frankly, we are overwhelmed with the information that we're finding this year. I have 300 measures to review when I get back to my office in St. Gallen this evening. And we found 150 protectionist measures in the first quarter of this year, and I suspect we have probably found another 150 as well. So this evidence is beginning to mount up, and I think it all points in one direction, that one of the root causes is that governments have injected many more distortions and a hell of a lot more uncertainty into corporate decision-making, and companies are adjusting. Okay? They're beginning to adjust, just as the General Electric example shows. So I think I would put on the table something which ought to be central to the role and purpose of this institution. Now, let me turn to what the G20 should do. Let's face it, ladies and gentlemen, we know what the G20 should do on protectionism. And quite frankly, they don't need to be told again, right? I think the real question is, what will it take to persuade the G20 to do what it knows it should do on protectionism? Okay, so that then I think turns the role over to those of us who are analysts and those of us in international organizations and the like. I think we need to start showing more and more concretely how these protectionist developments and these changes in corporate strategy that they're inducing are going to have consequences for living standards and jobs. Let's take that locomotive example. If General Electric is no longer going to produce locomotives only in the United States, there are going to be job losses in that facility. These jobs in export-paying industries are typically much higher-paying jobs. At a time when it appears the American public is freaking out about the implications of international trade, this is clearly not another loss they should suffer. And we need to find more and more examples of this. Now, I must say that many people have been contributing very positively to this. And I should add a number of analyses, good analyses from certain international organizations have helped as well, and researchers. So we are building up this library of evidence, which we have to find a way of communicating to policymakers what is at stake. Because they know what the right thing to do is. It's just that they have not made trade a priority. And I don't think trade has been a priority of the G20 for a number of years. I'm not sure how much it will be of a priority this year. And the signs for next year from Germany are not looking good, from what I understand. So I think we need to make clear, you know, despite all the nice rhetoric and all the diplomacy, that trade and openness is an exceptionally important factor. That firms, if the G20 doesn't adjust, firms will adjust, and they will adjust in ways which are not very beneficial. We have to, and we should reinforce this with examples. Let's take my home country, the United Kingdom, which has spent a lot of money trying to persuade General Electric to be exporting goods from the UK, as has the French government. Those investments, such as they are, might well be lost if GE decides to move all of the production closer to some of its customers in emerging markets. And we need to start making it very clear to governments that they've got a hell of a lot of stake here. All right. So I think the question I would leave, or 2 points I'd leave you with, is really let's focus on the root causes. So many of the analyses of the so-called global trade slowdown have focused on proximate causes, and you've heard some of them mentioned already. Let's focus on the root causes. For sure, protectionism isn't the only thing. There's going to be a demand slowdown that's going to play a role as well. But we should focus in on the policy variables we can have some leverage over, and then when it comes to the G20, the issue is not, it's not that they need to discover that protectionism is a bad thing. They need to be persuaded that doing something about this is important. And that shoveling it under the carpet and not discussing protectionism seriously in their trade and investment working group has got to stop. And that's really what's got to happen. Now, maybe our friends in Beijing and in Berlin will turn the corner on this, but I think we should be there to try and help them do the right thing and raise awareness of this issue. And I think that's the challenge before us.
Thank you. Time to wake up.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
Great. Let me pass it over to Anoop, please. Thank you.
Andrew, thank you very much. I'll just make a few points. Let me start by saying that, as Simon has emphasized, we are living through a kind of paradox. On the one hand, most measures tell us that global trade in commodities as measured, and financial flows have stalled in the past 7-8 years. This is a fact. However, this is also the time that protectionist sentiments have gone up. This is a paradox, because if trade has stalled, why is it that this is the time in which protectionist sentiments have gone up? So my own view is that we're entering a new world that requires much more work by us and the G20 to understand, are we entering a new world of digital flows that is changing the way the world is functioning? So let me make 5 points to you. The first is, as I think Hector clearly pointed out, Hector Torres, that although trade has stalled in terms of goods, it is becoming a reality that flows of what I call digital information, as others have emphasized, have surged. I think there is, we may not know exactly how it is measured, but it has surged. And information becoming available is telling us that this surge in information technology, broadly defined flows of digital information, is already explaining more of global growth than our traditional measures. Second point, if it is true that this flow of information technology has surged, why is it that the way we measure it, productivity, global productivity, and global growth have not surged? Because that is a fact. And as economists are looking at this, there is an emerging consensus, but we're not there yet, that we are misinterpreting measuring the impact of these flows on productivity and growth, and therefore it is likely, as Hector, I think, has emphasized, that productivity globally and growth globally are probably higher. And this is partly because the new information-intensive goods and services are very difficult to measure, partly because their costs are falling faster than we can measure, and this affects the measurement of real productivity and real growth. Now, third point, what are the implications of this, if this is true? The implications, I think, are quite fundamental, and they affect emerging markets, and they affect the United States in the following way. So far, we've lived through global manufacturing value chains where labor costs were paramount, and the emerging markets were explaining the majority of global trade. If we are moving into a new world of what I call digital globalization, this is playing not to the strengths of emerging markets, it's playing directly into the strengths of the United States. And if this is the case, it has fundamental implications for the next 10 years. Because if this is true, unless education and digital infrastructure changes in emerging markets, the center of productivity is going to be in the United States and the highly connected countries defined in a digital sense. So if this is true, we are moving away from productivity and growth coming from emerging markets and moving to this being now a strength of the United States. This has implications because precisely those countries in emerging markets that need to provide jobs and have growth with jobs will find it more difficult to do so. The positive implication is that if emerging markets develop the right digital infrastructure and openness to it, I'll come back to that in a moment, my sense is that even countries on the periphery will be able to benefit from what I call digital globalization as much as countries at the center of this. And what it means is SMEs and the micro SMEs, if they are given full access through their own digital infrastructure, it could positively change the implications for their development. So my bottom line is that how is this going to be managed? And so we have these regional agreements now emerging, such as the TPP, which I do believe is the first such regional agreement that focuses more on developing the standards of governance for digital flows than anything else so developed. My main point I want to make is that unless this is done globally and multilaterally, and the WTO must stand up to this, if this is not done globally and multilaterally, but regionally, my sense is that the costs of what we used to call trade diversion are going to be huge. And if emerging markets, or some emerging markets, lack the infrastructure domestically and don't build it because they are excluded from these regional agreements, the costs, what I call this trade diversion, is going to be huge. And it's going to be precisely in those countries that cannot afford it. So my sense is that if you're entering a new world, we have to move away from regional arrangements and do this multilaterally, because in my view, the cost to countries that are excluded from these digital flows are going to be huge. Thank you.
So we were just getting over dealing with the concept of value chains. Now you get us into this. Yes, very a lot of good points there, I think. Particularly, how do we conceive of trade openness, and how do we connect how do we take the connection to these technologies and make that connection to growth in a logic that is different than the predominant logic that we've used? Thank you. I'm sorry you've waited so long, Alessia. It's your turn.
That's okay.
Yeah, thank you.
Well, thank you, Chair. To be the last speaker in the panel, because I will have to keep you awake and not to say too many things that have already been said. Can I find my own? Okay. So we'll try to cherry pick some of the arguments that have been collected in the panel and also this morning. But doesn't seem to work. Sorry.
This one is not working. Try this one.
Okay, thanks. So my first point is, which has been influentially raised this morning as well, is that the G20 is actually a competitive advantage, as it was said this morning, in dealing with some of the issues that are on the table today, these years. As a key forum to restore global trade growth. And I'm not quite sure, as you know, Simon said, that the G20 actually know what they should be doing totally. Main factors that I think explain the competitive advantage of the G20 in dealing with these issues and that can be a bridge between different institutions, either organization, is that it is an intergovernmental group with both developed and major developing economies. So it must have an action-based agenda instead of a statement agenda. Everybody has. Mm. And it is also unique for having US and China as well as members. And everybody knows that US and China have a lot of conflicting issues on the table. And also not only for mega regions, but for a number of other reasons. So having these two major trading partners is a unique opportunity. But also, most of the untapped trade potential, either goods trade, services trade, today is in developing countries, both within the G20 and outside of the G20. So the G20 has also a responsibility to have spillovers on the non-G20 members, both within non-G20 and between the G20 and the non-G20. So the G20 has a number of things that only the G20 can do, I think. And this huge potential, I'm not quite positive normally, but I am now about the G20 potential, action agenda. And despite all the criticism that has been, thrown upon the G20, lacking of structure, lacking secretariat, and not dealing with issues but only making statements, there's a huge potential for the G20 to become operationally relevant. And I think there's a point that I will take in a minute again, that the Chinese presidency has gone along to be more operationally relevant, at least in trade and investment issues. And another potential comes from being more flexible than other institutions or fora. because it can bypass the universal agreement ideal, which is, of course, ideal. But the mass-based initiative or clubs are an option. Not free, not cost-free, but are an option to try to vehicle some of the issues that have been, you know, a cause for the deadlock of the Doha development round, and that can be, you know, tackled in small clubs and then, you know, to get an agreement from other partners. And another potential for the G20 is that maybe they should focus on what a G20 as a mission had from the beginning. So to focus on policies and initiatives that have the potential to reduce the negative spillovers or, you know, foster positive spillovers from national or regional policy differences, and not to deal with policies that national or individual countries can do themselves. Such policies are the kind of, you know, international public goods that the G20 only these days can do, because most of the potential, growth potential, comes from further linkages within the G20, but most of it between the G20 and the non-G20, and within the non-G20. So there's also an international public responsibility on the part of the G20 to get on board the non-G20 to restore global growth. So this is a true international public good. So how can the G20 work to remove obstacles? There are, you know, three major obstacles we have been, you know, acknowledging, and everybody almost agrees on that. Trade costs, barriers to services trade, and regionalization of trade. So the trade halt or slowdown, as you want to say, has cyclical factors, structural factors, and institutional or governance factors behind. Any G20 initiative to tackle each of these issues will be effective conditional upon two things. If the G20 will learn effectively, concretely, from the reasons for the Doha Development Agenda deadlock, that is, multilateralism is, of course, the first best, but it's not viable in certain policy areas. And maybe not necessarily efficient. This is very much, you know, disputed, and also not very clear, but it's not. It doesn't seem to many that multilateralism is efficient. For example, in agriculture, it may not be as efficient as we have been thinking, because agriculture has a smaller share in global trade than any other sector. So multilateralism in agriculture has been, you know, very difficult. But it is very important for many developing countries in terms of share on their own economies. So getting into an agreement, multilateral agreement on agriculture, is getting almost impossible. So let's take this on the table and move forward. The second condition is that it will be effective if it will consider the new features of global trade, as, you know, Simon has been saying, and also other speakers. Services account for 70% of GDP in many economies now, and an increasing share of goods trade is increasingly service intensive, so to say. So services trade is the thing the G20 has to tackle more and more, and it is increasingly intertwined with goods trade. So how to do that? But this is something the G20 should be doing. Each of the factors, reducing trade costs. Everybody agrees on that. Trade facilitation agreement within the WTO includes a number of measures that are needed. But always service-related elements, logistics, transport services, the digital infrastructure, which is a truly international public good that is highly needed to improve services trade. And developing economies have much more to gain than developed economies in this kind of, you know, digital infrastructure or communication infrastructure. The Chinese presidency has included a trade cost reduction target, which is a very ambitious one. Maybe too ambitious, because it is an individual country target. It's not an average country target. So it will be very hard for individual economies, which is good, to be very ambitious with oneself and with the rest of the group. But still, it's the right direction to go. And one thing that the G20 could do is to compare other experiences of trade cost reduction targets, as in the APEC experience in trade cost reduction. It has been done already in the past, some positive aspects, negative aspects. So compare what has been done with the APEC experience to go forward with the trade cost reduction target is very important. In terms of reducing barriers to services trade, of course, services, we know, figure centrally on the structural reform agendas, but were essentially taken off the WTO agenda. But they are the main issues in mega regionals and in the so-called new generation free trade agreements or PTAs, which it has been influentially said that new current trade agreements are not trade agreements, are something different. They deal with something which is different from trade. But these efforts also do not include most of the major emerging and developing economies who have the most to gain from that. So there's an urgent need to enhance service trade liberalization with an international infrastructure, or as you have said, in the digital infrastructure on a non-discriminatory basis. So the non-discrimination principle, the basic principle of this place, has to uniform still back our thought and input for the G20. So any regional trade agreements or plurilateral, multilateral, or bilateral, whatever, has to be considered only in terms of non-discrimination, because this is the only way to kind of start to assess whether they are not going towards multilateralism or not, because I think it's not an issue. Whether they are apt to welcome more countries to join or not. And for the same reason, the trade and services agreement should not become a PTA, but should be eventually part of GATS. Third point, the institutional governance factors for the trade slowdown, regionalization. We have been seeing in some of the slides before that regional trade agreements have been increasing enormously since the 90s and before 2008 and also after 2008. But trade has not, because regionalization is one of the reasons why trade has not increased, because they deal with non-trade issues. And they are creating new barriers in terms of rules, regulations, standards, which are ambitious and are acknowledged to be very positive issues in trade agreements. But they are somehow blocking new trade relations. So they have to be handled much more deeply than now. It has also been said that mega regionals or mega trade deals and PTAs are somehow on the same table, but they are not. Because regional trade agreements and preferential trade agreements have been increasing in number in a sense, in a market-based perspective, so to say. So they were following what markets were already being, creating. But mega regionals are trying to divert what markets have been creating. So they either will be either non-effective because they won't be able to change all the trade relations that have been creating in the past, or they will divert trade massively. Because they are more institution-driven than market-driven. So the non-discrimination principle here is crucial because it will prevent outsiders from being able to even assess whether they want to join or not. China's been among the most active countries in negotiating PTAs. So the presidency this year has a right as well as a responsibility to have the G20 move forward to include in the agenda some of the actions which are mostly needed for having not more coherence between regionalism and multilateralism, because it is not going that direction now, but at least to monitor. To monitor, it has already been said this morning and today, monitor the impact of regionalization in a structured way. And then center, as they are doing now, center on reducing trade costs and improving access to services for firms, not just market access for goods, but access to for firms to services, which are enabling trading, also for small firms in developing economies. That digital infrastructure will be fostering trade enormously compared to any other measure now, because the untapped potential is not between the US and EU. So the TTIP, of course, will not have massive diverting effects on other third members, because the untapped potential is not there. It is in services trade between developing economies and the rest of the world. And another action that should be included is to commit to more effective monitoring and analysis of trade policy broadly defined. This is something we haven't been talking at all until now. But trade policy also includes subsidies, investment incentives, tax incentives, or fiscal, and any other positive measures that create a number of huge negative spillovers on third economies. That should be included in the agenda in our discussion, because that creating massive trade distortions. Although it has, because it has a huge positive domestic effect, but a number of huge international negative spillovers, and we have not been talking about. In the agenda, in last December in Beijing, there was international fiscal coordination, or whatever you call it, which is a huge topic in the agenda, and that should be one of the first ones, because the positive domestic impact has huge negative international spillovers, and that's the mission of the G20. To avoid negative spillovers on the rest of the world, within the G20 and outside of the G20. And then there are a number of other issues, non-directly trade-related, but they are, you know, multilateral, you know, by nature. International migration, for example. I will only mention this, but this is a huge topic that should be included in discussion in the G20, because it is also, it has also a number of economic, or political, of course, social effect, but a number of economic effects in terms of labor movement, wages, wage differentials, and that should be tackled from the scratch on a multilateral basis, not left to bilateral negotiations, to EU, to the Mediterranean, or whatever. This is something that the G20 should be doing from scratch. Okay, thanks.
Thank you very much. I get a lot out of that, including, I think, overarching, I would say, design to purpose on principles. Think of the metrics about what you want to deliver, among others. So we have about 20 minutes for discussion. So I'd like to actually come back to our panel at the end, because you have all been very patient. Open the floor up to questions, comments, your own ideas. So the floor is open, please. Yes, Poskert.
Thank you. I have three questions, maybe three comments. First, when we during all the discussion of the panelists, they usually refer to EU, US, and China, but don't ever forget there is Brazil and India, as Alejandra has just mentioned. So in the trade arena, the P5, permanent five, are those five. So if they agree on something, that goes going to be quite substantial for the rest of the members. The second point I want to make is the digital trade. If that, then that goes, the question goes to Mr. Torres before he tilts over the chair. But then, you're insinuating, you're saying that the volume of trade is falling down, but at the same time, digital trade is moving up. But then also, Mr. Singh mentioned that the transaction, the money transaction, the international transaction is also going down. So if something cannot be measured, it cannot be controlled, and the presence of that thing, I mean, that improvement, cannot be, it's like a ghost. I mean, it some things that it is there, but the others do not. So if digital trade is not a public good, and if it is transacted, then there should be a money return. So the money-wise, there should be some way to control it. Mm-hmm. This is what I want to mention. And the last point, the new agreements are mostly on harmonization of regulations, of course. That is the NTBs. I mean, that's where the main the thrust of the whole game is. It is not the market access, but it is the rules that may change the whole system. Thank you.
Thank you. Other comments? Yes, sir.
Thank you, Chairman. I have a comment on the global trade and growth. I think that the G20 countries should make and implement some trade growth strategies. So G20 countries can make good use of some new issues of related to trade, such as the efficient measures, such as cross-border e-commerce, investment, global value chains, and SMEs to promote global trade growth. Especially, G20 countries should create small new global or regional value chains and encourage developing country and MSEs to participate in the value chains. Meanwhile, these value chains capacities should be raised. For example, I think that China's One Belt, One Road initiative will consolidate the regional cooperation through the regional value chains established. So my viewpoint is that the value chains are still the major impetus to the global trade growth fundamentally. Thank you.
Great, thank you. More questions, comments from the floor, please. Yes.
I would just like to comment on the presentations of the first two speakers. I think we've all noticed a kind of strategic shift from some major advanced countries, shifting by promoting labor-intensive production back at home, and also relocating some of the industries back at home. And this strategy has further intensified during the global financial crisis. I think this strategy shift has also a reason because in nowadays it is more difficult to have taxation arbitrage, labor cost arbitrage, or regulation arbitrage. So I hope China would really study very carefully why the advanced economies has pursued this strategy. Moving in and out will be costly. So I think when China thinking about going abroad because of labor cost differentials, it should be going at a measured pace, be selective. And I think also the world is very appreciative that during China's presidency, China is emphasizing the SDGs and also the inclusiveness and also income equality. So I hope trade, international trade, will also perform these kind of roles. So it's just a comment. So I actually reinforcing that volume is not really the key, and you need also to think about quality and sustainability and also income equality. Thank you.
This is addressed to Simon. What would make the protectionist trends reverse?
Sorry about that. I thought the comment, especially by Mr. Torres and Mr. Singh, about this new phenomenon that we are not properly capturing through our data and through our paradigms what's really happening, the fact that we may be missing the real picture. And Mr. Singh called it digital globalization, and Mr. Torres provided some statistics from McKinsey and so forth to back up the fact that we may be not focusing on what's a big phenomenon that's driving the future of trade. My question is the following. Mr. Singh mentioned that the next step or the way forward would be to focus on the right infrastructure to make sure that countries can tap into this phenomenon, and especially to provide opportunities for the developing world to not miss out on this new phenomenon. So what is this right infrastructure? Is it huge investment in IT type services, data banks, communications technology? How can we make sure that countries don't miss this boat? Thank you.
Thank you, Chairman. Chen Youjun from Shanghai Institute for International Studies. Some comments on the GVC, Global Value Chain. Yeah, when we talk about GVC, we also say that GVC can offer the opportunity for the SMEs, especially in the developing countries, to participate into the global value chains, and also make those make those manufacturers in the developing countries to decline their manufacture cost. However, I don't think so. Because after the financial crisis, many countries, especially the developed countries, initiated the reindustrialization, and many manufacturers. Which is set by the which is located in the developing countries, go back to the developed countries. So it means many developing countries lost the chances to participate into the GVCs. So my opinion is that maybe we can talk about something like the developed countries should offer some technology assistance to the developing countries, and make more and more SMEs in developing countries to participate to the GVC again. Thank you.
I'll take two more questions, please, Said, and then Eileen.
Thank you. Simon gave an example of the General Electric. It was very interesting that companies make changes of policy due to protectionist reasons, and this is impressive. And how costly is this to the companies, especially when we take this example, a big multinational, but how about the SMEs, for example, in adjusting themselves to new situations where they have to make policy changes?
I have a question also along the lines of SMEs and the digital globalization. I mean, we seem to be hearing a mixed story, and I'm just wondering if the panelists could enlighten us further, because there's, on the one hand, the narrative that the SMEs will be the ones that will benefit from this digital globalization. On the other hand, there is the reality also, as we all know, is that there is a digital divide. So what is going to be the prognosis, the situation for SMEs, especially from developing countries? Someone mentioned the eBay at the beginning of this panel, and I think I read somewhere recently that actually, whilst we all can buy eBay products, apparently only 24 countries actually can get onto the eBay platform as suppliers. So it's not really so easy for SMEs to get out there in the global digital world, because there are so many legal and other regulatory barriers and technology barriers. So when we are thinking as the global community or the G20 or, as a global community, when we're thinking about setting multilateral rules for the global digital economy, how do we do so that we don't increase this wealth gap between the rich and poor?
Good question. Let me, if I can now, just go back to our panel, if you'll permit me, and give each of you a couple of minutes to any questions that were directed to you or you'd like to address, and particularly any you'd like to address to other people who spoke on the panel. So let me just start in our order that we started with Hector.
Okay, thanks. And thanks for the questions. Let me start by the first question, which is possibly, I find it very challenging. How is this a ghost trade? If you cannot measure it, maybe it doesn't exist. Maybe why should we care about this?
Paid.
Huh?
If it is not paid for.
If it's not paid for, even more. Well, the point is that, first of all, I'm not trying to say that digital trade leaves no traces at all in value, in price. Some of this you pay, and indeed, even the digital possibly trade, when you download an application and you don't pay for it, or when you use a search engine in the web and you don't pay for that, you actually don't pay for that, but you are the product, because the company is passing commercial ads, or the company selling information, very valuable information, on your consumption preferences. So that is in the books of the companies. Now, that you could see. Now, the point is to what extent that implicit price, let's say, the value of your consumption preferences, that you are somehow disclosing and they're selling to somebody else, to what extent that can reflect the value of this trade? And that's a difficult question. I would like to have an answer, but I don't. But what I can tell you is that since the marginal costs of delivering bytes is virtually zero, even an explosion of digital information would not be leaving traces in, say, banking transactions, international banking transactions. So you would not know if that is about external trade or not. It is increasingly difficult, in my view, to discern what is international and what is domestic. And in the digital world that we're moving to, the difference between international trade and trade in general, I would say, is going to be more and more difficult to discern. To discern that, you may need to interfere with that. And that's one. Let me give you also something that is maybe incipiently reshaping production and maybe also one of the explanations why there's some inshoring. There is this machine-to-machine communication, okay? Increasingly, machine-to-machine communication. Now, of course, this has to have profound effects on jobs, on GDP, on productivity, and on trade measurements. As I said, even an explosion of transborder bikes may not leave sufficient traces for us to see it, to detect it in banking transactions. 3D printer mixed with machine-to-machine communication. 3D printer is about building manufacturers by adding layers of products of a product rather than carving and scrapping materials. So you could move the production to the consumption market and send the information for that machine to produce it in the consumption market. That would disappear from trade. You are producing in the consumption market. You are reducing, it's as if you say, rather than using your drying machine to dry your clothes, suddenly you start hanging it. It disappears from GDP. In this case, it would disappear from trade. And I also spoke with General Electric, by the way, with one official at the General Electric, not as high official as the one Simon spoke with, but he confirmed that General Electric is using 3D printer increasingly. It is not using it for massive production. It is using it for tailored production. And those 3D printers indeed can be put in the consumption market. So that is one reason. I don't know how important right now, because this is incipient, to wonder whether there is some trade flowing under our noses. And this trade, rather than being volume, it's about digital, and the volume is produced in the consumption market. So I would leave it there. So I leave some other. I could comment on protectionism afterwards if you want, but I don't want to steal time from the rest.
Thank you.
Thank you. And a short comment for the first question about the why only USA, EU, and China, not Brazil and India. I think, this is the key members in WTOs, especially for DD, Doha development round. But outside WTOs, maybe not as many. Yeah. And second comments for the UFND's question about the re-industrialization and onshores for the some of the industries come back to the industry countries. I think this is something we need to close look at, especially for the near futures, because not only for the government have some policy to encourage this this trend, and also we already get some of the new strategy and also behavior changes from the firms, firm level. So if the government and the firms work together, that'd be a new trend in the future, and also have a huge implications for the for the trade and also for the economy in the future. Thank you.
The ambassador's first question and the inclusive RDP 5. I think one thing that is like India and Brazil is not part, it's also part of the RCEP, Regional Comprehensive Economic Partnership. The negotiation where that is basically aspirational, that is inclusive of other emerging economies. If you saw that, follow the directions, it is moving one step ahead and then going left and right, and basically they are in the same position. But this reflects basically of other emerging economies like Brazil and India. I think whatever the outcome will be a good learning exercise for the WTO. And the second is my response is more about the SMEs and our micro, small, and medium enterprises, and where that is we can learn from the experiences from Asia, where nearly 30% of the SMEs are in the global value chain. And here, basically, there are some of the global, there is SMEs along the global value chain getting benefiting from their mother companies through their supplier technical assistance program. For example, Toyota, and they are helping their companies in this second and third tier companies, even through this digitalization by providing the market information and also providing the access to the finance. That kind of models could be emulated. But still, we had a lot of challenges, particularly that is embracing this IoT and the digitalization of the technology. Only a day before yesterday, we had a research working group meeting on this application of this Industry 4.0 for the SMEs, and where we identified five technological areas where these SMEs can look on the skill development. That include big data management. Second is Internet of Things. Third is artificial intelligence. And fourth one is this digital printing. Final one is this renewable energy storage. These are the areas that is where that is further capacity building and the skill development is necessary. Stop here.
Thank you. So I was asked questions about essentially how to reverse protectionism. I think I would work at two levels. The first is we need to get out the message on who gets hurt by these measures much more, to the extent that downstream buyers, including those in global value chains, are impacted. We need to make that clear, and we need to get those statistics out faster so that as governments are making decisions, they can see that if they put a tariff on steel, then all the users of steel are going to get clobbered, and that there's going to be a lot more jobs lost and possibly exports lost downstream. We need to get that information out. Where I agree with Alicia, there are indeed a lot of subsidies and tax breaks which have been introduced during the crisis era, especially as they relate to promoting exports, and these are costing serious money. So once you add up the cost of these, I would have thought we could get treasuries and the IMF, our friends of the IMF, on board and pointing out that there is a side to, there's a side to beggar thy neighbor policies which impacts on public finance. We could get them on board to the extent that protectionist measures and trade distortions affect developing countries. We should be able to get development ministries on board as well. So I think as this information gets out, people work and move with it faster, we should be able to build faster, better, bigger constituencies to push back during public policy processes. Site mentioned SMEs. Now, for some reason, many policymakers have romantic notions about SMEs. Some people say that they're very good for supporting the rise of the middle class, which is a perfectly legitimate non-economic argument, to the extent that those arguments are persuasive with policymakers, let's use them as well. Yeah. So I think there's that's one level one should approach this. There's a second and deeper level that we have to work as well, and that is that I think that many governments turn to beggar thy neighbor policies when they think they're running out of alternative tools. And at the moment, many governments don't think fiscal policy works. An increasing number don't think monetary policy works. And so the only way that they can, one of the ways they think they can bolster aggregate demand is by stealing market share on world markets. That's one way in which, you know, failure of macro policy spills over into protectionism. And by the way, one of the reasons why I'm more worried now than I was, I have been for a number of years. Another thing we have to try and persuade governments to do is they should protect people and their skills, not particular jobs. So I think that, you know, there's a lot of work done on the initiatives in Denmark and elsewhere on flex security. These are interesting initiatives. Obviously, one can't copy one country's policies unthinkingly to other countries, but we need to think about, you know, this principle of protecting people, not jobs. Particular jobs. And I think once you start addressing these more fundamental needs, governments can see that they don't need to resort to protectionism. So that, I think, builds up arguments. So I think there is an approach there. And the deeper question inside Jean-Pierre's and others' comments is, when I think about what's the role the T20 can play, I mean, forgive me if I say this, but I've heard many presentations today and many of the other T20 events where people list all the nice things the G20 should do, okay? And it's like Christmas, right? It just feels like Christmas. So the G20 should. I mean, what matters is change management. How do we get countries to change, or governments to change what they're doing in this particular forum? And I think we. I don't want to shut down discussions on anything, but I do think we need to diversify discussions in the G20 to how do we persuade governments to take collective action in the right areas, not just what's the what's our latest wish list of all the things we'd like the G20 to do. So for those of you who are going to take responsibility for the T20 in the year ahead, in our German institutions and the like, and afterwards, I hope you think about that, because we need to do as much more work on that as we do on the Christmas trees. Thank you.
Yeah. Thank you. Very briefly, I just make 2 points. Firstly, the question was raised, why are we not seeing clearer evidence of the effects of these new technology? And I think it's quite clear that there are lags between innovation and productivity. We've seen this through time. And I think my sense is that it's taking time for the new technology to become widespread and used in goods and services and lead to higher productivity growth. My point is, this is my second point, the productivity frontier that emerging markets have been trying to achieve, the growth frontier of advanced countries, is probably now more becoming a technological frontier. And unless their internal domestic digital infrastructure allows that, it's going to become more difficult to reach the frontier. So it's very clear that in many developing countries, we have the reality that connectivity is too slow and unreliable, and businesses simply cannot take advantage of the new innovation. That is domestic digital infrastructure. The second part is, even if it is available, I am concerned that if regional trade agreements are going to focus on how to propagate or use this infrastructure externally, countries that are not in these arrangements could suffer from significant trade diversion effects. It comes down to both domestic infrastructure and external access. And if this is realized, we're going to see implications for income and wealth inequality, which will be worse than what we see today.
I just have 2 points. One, again, on digital trade. There was a big read in the FT some weeks ago on the digital trade. Very interesting data with a composite index they have been coming up with, weighting different kinds of digital trade, what can be measured, also downloads from platform, free platform, so that can be done. And they show that for the first time ever last year, digital trade in value, measured as such, was larger than goods trade. So it seems to me quite bizarre that in a panel and in this place, we have to rely on McKinsey index about measuring digital trade, and we should come up with some more official or something measurement of digital trade or whatever you want to call it. For example, this is something that shouldn't be left to private sources, right? And a second point, but this was larger, so it means it's increasingly important in size and volume, whatever you measure. The second point to Yufen's comment about labor cost differentials. Well, international wage differentials have been shrinking because in low wage countries they have been rising, China on top of that, and in high, at least in real terms, and in higher wage countries they have been decreasing in real terms. So this is something that we should also consider positive in terms of income convergence, right? And so if this is the major economic factor or one of the major economic factors explaining the structural reason why there's been inshoring or reindustrialization in advanced economies, it shouldn't be only considered as a strategy for multinationals, but also something that has been going on structurally. And also China as being in part of the story here, not just advanced economies. If you go to China, industry 4.0 or whatever you call it is very high on the agenda of the new industrial policies in China. So robotization and mechanization also in China is an issue. So I'm not quite sure that in shrinking international wage differential is against income convergence or is only a strategy of multinational and not something which is more widespread in terms of economic trends now. That's it.
Thank you very much. I'm not going to attempt to summarize. I just wanted to pick on a couple of points that that spoke to me around the digital, where we are spending a fair amount of time. You are the product. Yeah, we have to really think about it differently, and we'll be forced to think about it differently. The comment about eBay and about access to these digital systems is actually a big issue. Whether you can get on. We had a session in Nairobi in December where a lot of the comments from African businesses were about lack of infrastructure to actually create and get onto global systems. But even at the national and regional level, the ability to monetize the huge amount of creativity that is there and protect it. And then just a comment, there is some really interesting work around digital trade barriers. Some of you may know about it. ESIPE is developing that. So there's a lot of activity. So let me end there. We are either over time or under time, depending on whether you're looking at the amount of time we took or you're looking at the agenda. So I hope you'll forgive us or thank us. And please thank our panel, who did a fantastic job. Thank you.